run Scruggs back among us, so, on many levels. So, welcome home. Well, I'm not really one to be given to too many vices. Sugar, maybe. Never liked smoking. My drinking days are long behind me. I like a good book, I like a good meal, and I appreciate good company. But I do have one addiction. When I was a middle schooler, my grandfather gave me one of his radios. And my grandfather was one of those people that never got rid of anything. And when we cleaned out my grandparents' house in 2001, most everything that was there that had been in the house when he was growing up. So we had all of not just his things, but my great-grandparents' things. But when I was in middle school, he gave me a 1937 radio that he bought when my grandparents married. And after he died, I inherited a 1928 model that my great-grandparents had bought during the Depression. And over the years, I picked up one radio after another until two radios became a few dozen. Because if one radio is good, a few dozen must be better, right? From childhood, I loved music, and I loved anything that played it. I amassed a sizable collection before I finished high school, from albums to 8-tracks, to cassettes, to CDs, and finally to those little downloadable files on my phone. I don't like those, because I don't get lined up. I always loved music. I love old school country, classical, alternative, pop, and a little of everything in between. If you come into my office here or at home, you'll hear NPR or maybe music on my iPod or Spotify or Pandora or YouTube on my computer. In college and after, I rarely miss the best concerts coming anywhere through the state of Tennessee. And one thing I figured out much too far into adulthood is that I detest silence. A casualty of the countless concerts I attended in my 20s is quite a bit of hearing loss. And with that hearing loss comes a troublesome ringing in my ears that some of you may know. And it's made bearable, ironically enough, by having noise. Something going on in the background. So I rarely have a moment in my life without someone speaking or singing or playing, and I'm not alone. Life in our modern culture is a constant flurry of activity, a constant influx of stimuli to our senses, a constant flow of news from our Twitter accounts and Facebook and Instagram and whatever else we have plugged ourselves into. We have the option of unrelenting input 24 hours a day, and many of us choose to do it. Sometimes a friend on Facebook will post that they are taking a day or a week or a month off of Facebook, and I read their post and I think, how quaint you would take time off from social media. Albert Einstein has been quoted as saying, I think 99 times and find nothing. I stop thinking and swim in silence and the truth comes to me. How many of us have been in a quandary, trying to figure out an answer or a direction to no avail and then just stop and give ourselves the evening off? And stop working on it and stop thinking about it. And then the answer seems to fall right into our laps. Prophet Elijah was fleeing the reach of Jezebel when he ended up at Mount Horeb, known better to you and me as Mount Sinai. And the word of the Lord came to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" Elijah says, "The Israelites have ruined everything. And now I am the only faithful one left." And the Lord says to Elijah, go stand outside. I'm going to walk by. So Elijah goes and stands outside the mouth of the cave where he's staying. And a great and powerful wind blows through and shatters rocks, and blows things over and generally makes a big mess, and then the wind is gone. But God was not in the wind. And then there was an earthquake. And surely God would come in an earthquake. If God was going to come, of course he would come in an earthquake. But God was not in the earthquake. And then there was a fire. You've heard that the wise men showed up at the manger sooty and smelling, right? Because they came from afar. Sorry. I had to. I really did. I'm sorry. But God was not in the fire. And after the fire came nothing. The text says that nothingness was a gentle whisper. The Hebrew literally says that after the fire came a sound of sheer silence, or a sound of fine silence. Elijah encounters God not in the mighty wind, or in the earthquake, or in the fire, but in the face of the silence. Elijah covers his face in reverence. The sacred moment is not the one we would expect, because God is found here not in the presence of something, but rather in the absence of it. And I wonder how many sacred moments we have missed because God got drowned out in all the noise of our lives. I wonder how many times God was there just waiting to be acknowledged, and we failed to create the space for God to be. I've learned some useful skills in seminary. And I have to tell you, this is probably, it's one of my top five favorites, let's say that. So any of us in ministry, most of us are fixers. We want to do something or to say something. It's helpful. And one of my professors teaches us that in a ministry of presence, instead of teaching us, don't just stand there, do something, he teaches us instead, don't do something, just stand there. He reminds us that in many ways, the most important thing that we can do in ministry, not just me to you, but you to one another, is to create a place of active silence, a space where doing nothing but listening is the most important thing that we can do. It runs counter to our culture of do, 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 to place silence above all the noise in our lives. In the silence lies one of the greatest ministry skills of all. Like I said, maybe God created us with two ears and one mouth for a reason. It's been a challenging summer for us at South Broadway on a number of levels. Our pastor left us to serve a congregation in Kansas. We have unanswered questions about our future together that are going to be complicated and time-consuming to work through. Many of us feel deeply and passionately about one viewpoint, and others of us feel deeply and passionately about others entirely. And in some cases, we've dug in our heels and we've drawn lines in the sand. And my friends, that's no way to do church. One thing that I think I can confidently say about this church is that every person here loves this community in ways that I have never experienced in any other church that I've been part of. This church is, for so many of us, the center of our spiritual and our social lives. We don't just love South Broadway, we love South Broadway. Amen. And sometimes we love it so strongly and so deeply that we just can't imagine a direction for the church other than our own. and we end up othering our brothers and sisters. If we didn't care, if the future didn't matter to us, we would not face the challenges that we do. And it is because of our love and commitment that we must seek ways to actively work together, even when we differ. So I'm going to ask you not to take your physical shoes off. That could become a problem. But I want you to take your spiritual shoes off. And I want you to stick your feet out, because I'm going to step on a few toes. If you think that your viewpoint is the only one that will work for the church, if you think that your viewpoint is the only one that is right, if you think that you just can't compromise, let me assure you that there are many valid viewpoints and many ways forward, in many ways that we can and will work together and compromise, and that no one of us gets our way, but that all of us dictate our future together, because we have a future together, and we will decide that future together. There is a bright future for us here, and we will make it. And I will reiterate that there is plenty of room at this spiritual table. The prophet Elijah teaches us a very, very important lesson in our text. In the fray of change, we get nervous. And we become talkers instead of listeners, or I do anyway. If God is in the silence, we need to trust that. We need to listen. We need to listen hard before speaking. We need to think before we respond. We need to allow space for our sisters and brothers to be and to share. In the weeks and months to come, the most important thing that we can do for one another is don't do something, just stand. We can and will create spaces, not just to share our own points of view, but to listen, to actively listen to our neighbor, to honor their perspective, to honor their journey, to honor their hopes and wishes and dreams for this community that we all hold so dear and close to our hearts. So going forward, we're going to get back to some basics. And I'm going to challenge us to spend less time sitting in meetings and more time building relationships. Less time combing over our past and instead living into our future. We are going to remember anew why we are called to this place. And we're going to put our living out the good news back on the top of our list of priorities. And I'll remind you again that there is nothing that we cannot do with love and with each other and with God on our side. May it be so. Amen. Amen.